Good morning, MACNA. Thanks for coming out so early on a Sunday morning. It's early for Colorado anyway. I hope everyone's having a really, really good time. There's still a lot to go down here at MACNA. We still have huge raffle drawings throughout the day, several more speakers, workshops. The DC Club is registering people for next year's MACNA at the pre-registration price, so we want to make sure to catch that. And our next speaker is a nice deviation from some of the topics that we've had. It's about invertebrates, it's about cephalopods, and it's about captive breeding. So please help me in welcoming Laura Birenbaum.
Hi there. A good friend of mine told me last night that I should rehearse the first sentence of my talk. I've been giving this talk a little bit, but this is my biggest audience. So I'd like to read you the following statement. Hello there. Thank you so much for inviting me to speak at this epic conference. I adore working with these bandensis cuttlefish, and I love sharing information about them with others. That makes this speaking opportunity, the MACNA, a real treat. So thanks for the MACNA committee and Jake for inviting me, and thanks to you guys for coming out to this lecture. Wait for applause. All right, so this is my talk, Breeding Bandensis Cuttlefish. And I am passionate about it, so I'm excited to tell you about it. Just to give you a little preview of what's about to go down, I'm going to give you a little background on myself. We're going to talk about husbandry. We're going to talk about their biology. And then we're going to get right into breeding. OK, so people often don't recognize because I haven't been going to the MACNAs for more than 5 years and I haven't been doing a lot of writing, but I've actually been working in the fish industry for 12 years now. I've had fish my whole life. I love diving. I started off working as a sales clerk at Dolphin Pet Village in California, and that, you know, was the typical slippery slope of starting with cichlids and then starting to breed discus, and then what's harder than discus? All right, let's get into saltwater, let's get into corals, and here I am. I volunteered at Steinhardt for a little while, and all these combinations made me want to make my career out of this. So I went to Western Washington University for my marine biology degree. When I was in Bellingham going to college, I started a fish shop, a reef shop, with another guy called the Chronic Reefer. And that name was as appropriate in Bellingham as it would be in Denver. Unfortunately, it wasn't great for a fish shop, I learned. It produced a lot of U-turns, as I called them, which was people coming in expecting one thing, getting quiet and frightened, and making a U-turn at the end of the shop, and coming out, and the best we would get out of them is muttering, "What is this place?" And then we'd have to explain, you know, what an aquarium is. And if they're really nice, they're like, "Can we buy some lights?" And I'd say, "They're $500. They're like, "What? No." So that was my shop. I decided to get into the wholesale industry, so I went to MACNA 5 years ago. And that's when I met Joe for the first time, Joe Waiulo. And at the same time, I met Chris Conti at Ice Cap. And I started working at Ice Cap. Remember Ice Cap, the lighting company? Love wholesale. So that was a great experience, even though it only lasted a year and a half before the company tanked. I learned a lot. I also went to ACAN Lighting after that. I did learn about LEDs and started writing a business plan for my end game, which was coral. That's a little shot of my humble little reef tank way back when. So being out east at Ice Cap, I got to meet this tank too, which is a 20,000-gallon reef tank at the Long Island Aquarium, co-founded and curated by this guy, Joe Waiulo. This tank is spectacular. This picture was taken by Joe's iPhone just before the conference, but you can see the colonies are 4, 5, 6 feet in diameter. It's really coming along, and this is my inspiration to really settle in. So even more impressive than this reef tank is my love for Joe. So happy 5th anniversary, honey.
Oh.
And I get the privilege of sharing Joe's family out east. He's got 3 wonderful boys. And even more exciting, I have privilege to get access to 20,000 gallons of mother colonies. And I'm looking at these, this is what I want to do. Look at this underutilized asset, being a wholesale business person. So I co-founded Reef Gen. This is the other co-founder, Justin Credible. We started building out troughs around Joe's Reef because Justin was in California at the time, and he gave me a call and he said, I'm working on a business plan for an aquaculture company. I said, I am too. And so we combined our ideas and we started this company. We're going to get into cuttlefish shortly. I just wanted to show you some of the corals that we get to propagate at Joe's Aquarium. But we also do some fish. So Todd Gardner was a breeder at a Long Island Aquarium. That's why a lot of these fish are named after him. And fish are fun. They're fine and well, you know, they're interesting. But you're always looking for that next high as a typical reefer. And then fish weren't really doing it for me. And then I saw this guy. And this guy's talk told me about the wonders of cuttlefish and cephalopods. And I knew that that would be a wonderful thing to get into. But I didn't really get the opportunity at the aquarium. The cuttlefish was being taken care of by somebody else until one day I was talking to Kevin Cohen from Live Aquaria. They care a lot of our corals. We're talking about corals. He's like, yeah, you guys breed a lot of cuttlefish, right? I was like, yeah, well, you know, the aquarium does. And he offered to send me some eggs. So he sent me an egg bundle of the bandensis cuttlefish. And this is what started my breeding career with the cuttles for the past couple years. So thanks to Live Aquaria for starting this all off. So captive breeding bandensis cuttles. These are bandensis cuttlefish. You can see they've got a wide variety of coloration. And I want to start off by, a lot of people say, oh, you're talking about the flamboyants. I'm not talking about the flamboyants. Bandensis are underrated. So that's what we're talking about, not the metasepia. Just to let you know, just one slide about it to wet your palate. It was bred, the aquarium, Long Island Aquarium, was one of the first places to captive breed flamboyant cuttlefish. Rachel is the current aquarist who's taking care of these cuttles. And they've got great personalities. They're difficult, they're more delicate, and they're difficult to breed. So it's been a challenge. And they're thought to be rare in the wild. Their population status isn't known. So importation of them is generally discouraged with the combination of them being difficult and hard to come by. So it's really recommended only to be imported for certified breeding programs. Back to bandensis. So what is a cuttlefish? On the left there, you can see that this is where they begin from, which is the phylum Mollusca, which is mollusks. So that's snails, clams, chitons. And then on the right, you can see how cephalopods fit in as a class. And that includes nautiluses, squid, octopus, bunch of weirdo deep sea classes. And then you get to the genus of Sepia, which is where the blue arrow is pointing to, and that's cuttlefish. So why to keep cuttles? They've got really charismatic personalities. This is one of my cuttlefish coming to say hello, giving me the cuttlefish finger, if you will, and looking for some food. They are very interactive with their owners. They don't escape aquariums like octopuses do, so you can keep them in open-top reef systems. And they're hardy and adaptable and great reef additions. So why not to keep cuttles? It's not all fun and games. They've got a short lifespan, which, you know, for people who would get desperately attached to this thing, you're going to lose them in about 12 months, give and take a couple months. When they ink, it is something you need to be prepared for. It will black out your tank and can be removed, and we'll talk about that later, but you need to be prepared for it. But the biggest burden that cuttlefish owners talk about is their demand for food. So they eat and a huge amount of food, which means they produce a huge amount of waste. One of the cuttlefish experts over in California once told me that they produce the most ammonia per kilogram of any of the invertebrates. And they can be a little bit delicate. You need to have proper reef parameters to make sure that they're functioning and growing and living happy. Feeding them can be involved too. But I think it's worth it. So, how to keep a cuttlefish. Cuttle tanks, if you have happy corals, you have happy cuttles. I think that's a quote from Rich. And it's recommended that you keep them in a 40-gallon tank, you could probably get away with a 20-gallon for one, maybe two, if they grow up together. And then you, the males will fight, so you need to make sure that you don't put two males together in a small tank, of course. I recommend, they can take any level of flow and lighting like a reef system, but I recommend offering low flow areas at the front of the aquarium so they have a place to rest. And species-specific tanks are best because they will probably eat any fish you put in there or get picked on. They're like seahorses in that way. You can also do cleanup crews, regular cleanup crews, so snails, hermit crabs, and the like, starfish. This is my breeding setup at the Long Island Aquarium. I've got these 100-gallon acrylic tanks that I've outfitted with dividers so that I can separate, add and remove dividers to separate males, to separate pairs, and to make sure that babies have the proper density. So the classic cuttlefish, this is the way that they're built. They've got eight arms, which is a classic cephalopod trait, and two retractile tentacles, so those are the long guys. They keep them tucked in these little pouches on either side of their mouth. And they also have a mantle where their gills and they excrete, and a lot of their organs are sort of open system. So that mantles their body plan, and they use their siphon to exhale and jet around the tank. They also have a cuttle bone, so it's, if you guys ever had parakeets or cockatiels, that's what they nibble on. Cephalopods are really smart, as you know. They're the smartest of the invertebrates. One theory of why they're so smart is they think that because cephalopods have evolved without an external shell like snails and clams, that they need to be smart enough to camouflage and escape predators. They also have to operate a full body system of color and texture changes, and they need, and they have highly articulated arms, so it takes some knowledge to get that all going. And part of the color change you can see is they produce a rainbow colors, and they'll change these colors in an instant. They have chromatophores, which produce these color changes, and chromatophores are specialized cells with pigments, and with a combination of muscular contractions and dilations, they can either expose these pigments, increase the translucency and the reflectivity, which is what produces all these color changes. That helps them communicate in social interactions and warn off predators. Here's some more cuttles. You can see on the right, they're not doing a great job at camouflage, and that's a classic juvenile coloration. They just go with white unless somebody gets too close, and then they'll get dark, kind of a darker red, but usually they're that white color. So here's more camouflage. These babies in the deli cup in the middle, they got all sorts of colorful, but you can see they can go from white and smooth to zebra, black and white to brown, little shades of red and yellow. So, 50 shades of cuttle. You can see in this close-up that you can see those chromatophores expanding and contracting on the siphon and on the head. And I'm calling this emotional color changes, but what I really mean is it's communication, it's interaction. So she's looking at me and she's saying, don't come over here, you know, I'm gonna stay here, you stay there. And this is really interesting. This guy is going to display the two-face coloration, which is he's trying to get in behind that coral to get away from me, so he's showing a sort of white submissive coloration towards me. And if you look on the other half of his body, he's showing a more aggressive, let me in, I need to get out of here coloration. And that's something that males will do to show females the soft side and males on the other side of them the more aggressive side. You can also see their bioluminescent patches on the fin that surrounds their mantle. And that's something that's unique to bandensis. It's not bioluminescent, but it's a blue luminescent. It's a different type of process. So there he is. It's a cutie. This one is a communication between a male and a female. That male is in the back approaching the female, and she is exhausted. They were introduced that day, and he has been very aggressive with her all day in a needy kind of way, and there she is pressed against the glass trying to avoid him. Let me out of here. It's too much. This is that dark, smooth coloration. Very pretty. to click it to get the title off. Here's a feeding coloration of one of my more tame cuttlefish. You can see when they get really excited, they'll change colors a lot. They're good looking. So let's talk about the inking. So inking, the ink from cuttlefish is not poison. It's used in inks for pasta. It's used in inks for, you know, art. But what it is composed of is mucus and melanin, which is the pigment that all of us have. They produce two types of inking patterns. It's pseudomorphs and smokescreens. Pseudomorphs is the Latin for false body, so they'll produce a little blob and then jet away, hoping that the predator hits the blob instead of them. Or the smokescreen is what's happening right there, which is just a huge cloud of ink, and then they tuck away into the background. Inking usually happens only when they're particularly panicked. So I want to show you about their locomotion. This is going to demonstrate he's got the fin moving that will levitate him, and he's got his two feet at the very end of his body that they will use for walking, and that's something that's also unique of the dwarf cuttles, the flamboyants and the bandensis. They use their cuttle bone for buoyancy, so they can actually increase and decrease the amount of gas and water in their cuttle bone to give them more loft or more weight. Hitting the button. Come on. Here we go. So let's talk about the food. These are the grass shrimp. This is Palamedes. It's actually vulgaris. And it's a shore shrimp that's common on the Atlantic coast from the Gulf of Mexico all the way up to, I believe it's like Maine. Something that anybody can go out and collect with just a regular fish net, scrape it along bulkheads of docks. And it's an excellent, excellent food source for cuttlefish, and it's something that you can not only raise them with, but bring them to breeding conditions. They'll also eat small crabs and small fish. You want to minimize fish as part of their diet because there's some evidence that it is not healthy for them, and it can, if you feed a fish-only diet, they won't grow as well. You can train cuttles onto frozen food. They're interested right away, but it takes work. I feed all my cuttlefish live because it would take, I've got, you know, a couple hundred of these guys, and it would take too much time to go around to each one, which I have when I've run out of live grass shrimp, and holding the prawn under their little mouth as they puff at me going, I don't know, for 1 to 3 minutes, if you do that with every single one of the cuttles just to get the meat, it's a lot of work. But if you just have a couple cuttles, it's very doable. You can also do frozen food mobiles, where you're dangling them. That's a system that Rich actually developed. You dangle the frozen food from a piece of fishing line and have a little epoxy weight at the end, and then they can just pull it off of a toothpick or pull it off of the line, and that way it stays up in the water column and fakes them out that it's something live and wonderful. Food size is very important for the adults. They're more flexible. They can take anything from, you know, a third of their body size to twice their body size, or maybe even three times their body size if they're feeling ambitious, as you can see from that cuttle on the bottom holding onto a giant restaurant prawn that I gave him. But, you know, that is an inefficient food to feed him because there's a lot of waste, and he's only going to chew through a chunk of it and then abandon the rest. So getting the right size food is important, and I'm actually talking to a couple of frozen food companies to see if we can get something the size of a ghost shrimp in frozen food form to make it easier. So the feeding mechanism of these cuttlefishes is they have this buccal mass where they will chew through their food, their chewers, and that's what you can see in this video, that pulsing on his forehead. And that's important because in the nervous system slide that I was showing earlier, you would see that the esophagus is actually going through the middle of the brain. So it's important they chew their food well, otherwise they may have a stroke or something. I'm sure they have it figured out. They've been evolved for a while. So often you'll see this floating around in your tank. That is cuttlefish poop. So here's the equipment. I pulled this online. I've tested this guy, but this is what a cuttlefish does if he has a misfire. Lots of times if you're feeding your cuttlefish and he strikes and he misses the shrimp, he'll attach to whatever surface he hits with his feeding tentacles, and his arms will try to wrap around it. It feels like part of their feeding mechanism is conscious and thoughtful, and the other part is subconscious. And it's just a physical reaction, because if you can trigger one or two of those arms to accept a piece of frozen food or accept a shrimp, the rest will wrap around it without them thinking too much about it. They have that sharp little radula beak thing in the middle, and that is not always helpful when you're trying to sell and ship these cuttlefish around the country, because when they get pissed off, they'll do that to the bag and I end up with leaks. Which is awesome if you're trying to make a shipping deadline at like 5 o'clock and then your cuttlefish chews through the first three bags that you put them in. Once you get them in there, I haven't had too much trouble. I'm very, very lucky that I haven't had any DOAs in shipping. So they are actually very sturdy shippers. These cuttlefish have quite the reach. Unfortunately, this is a picture of dead cuttlefish, and one of the things that happens with their when they die is that often their feeding tentacles will extend. So I wanted to show you how long they are. So I have a soundtrack to some of this stuff. So let's see if we can do both. I want to show you the strike of the cuttlefish. One of the things that always charmed me about these guys is when they hit the shrimp, it's like a dart with these two feeding tentacles, so fast. But when they grab the shrimp into their mouths, they often have, almost always have, the legs and the claws of the shrimp facing away from them and the back facing towards them. And I was wondering, how do they do that? So I tried to slow this down and I learned a little something. If you watch, when they strike, they're usually pretty careful to hit just the arch of the back instead of the side of them or the front of them. And so there goes that dart, and the feeding tentacles extend at the last minute around the shrimp. And then he pulls it in, and he has lunch. I'm going to keep going just because I'm at 20 minutes, and I don't want to go too long. There we go. So now we're talking about breeding the bandensis. Bandensis and the bees. So cuttlefish are dioecious, which means they're not like clownfish. They don't change sex. It's a male and a female separately. Males will spar a lot when they're going through when they reach breeding age. And that is something that consumes a huge amount of their time. It can be deadly, and again, this is about stocking densities and making sure that you have a lot of females compared to the number of males in the tank. Otherwise, they'll be fighting and chewing on each other. The way they do it is males deposit a spermatophore bundle, this little fuzzy puffball, into the female's mantle, and then her genital pore will bring it in, fertilize the eggs, and then she lays the eggs. One of the things that's been documented in cuttlefish is they will actually remove the rival spermatophore from another male cuttlefish that may have inseminated her earlier by jetting out any spermatophores that's in her mantle. So I'm not sure if bandensis do that, but it's been documented in other sepia. So here's an important thing about cuttlefish is sexing. It's very difficult to sex a cuttlefish unless they're displaying the extreme version of male coloration, which you can see in the middle, that black and white stripes, because females can be mottled like the male on the left and the male on the right. But if you see them flare out their tentacles, then you can know it's a male. All right. Oop. I have some more notes. Went too far. I'm going to see if I can get the music. I want to show you how males spend the majority of their... Can you hear me like this?
Yeah.
They're doing the business, like a female style. They spend a lot of time showing off their vitality and their vigor. That's that shield pattern that they're doing. And if they're eating, they often get... Oh, Can you hear me now? That's nice, right? Okay. All right, can you hear me? All right, so some of it is about posturing. Some of it is about showing your stature as a male. And they will spend all day and all night doing this. I come in one night, squinting in the tank, what is going on in there? And this is what I see. I'm sexy and I know it. There's a lot of hormones pumping through these guys. They are super juiced up. And they've got a lot to say about it. So here's that food aggression. This guy has that giant prawn, the other cuttles are hungry, and they're looking at him trying to steal his lunch. Often they'll strike on the food, so he's showing the back off coloration as well. You're looking to show off how strong and worthy you are. And here's two cuttlefish that are in neighboring containers, but you can see they only have that window, and that's the reason why I do the windows. It's for flow, but I don't want them to see each other because they will spend all day doing this and less time eating and breeding and other functional things that I want them to do other than just show it off. I'm sexy and I know it. It can be aggressive. That guy is doing the unsure puff going across, but not all the displays are successful. Here's that posturing. They're trying to show their broadest side to the other male. They have to keep a particular position, so that's the wiggling. All right, that worked, right? I guess you missed the first part, but that's okay. That's my favorite video. All right, here's the consequence of male sparring, is they will latch on to the other side of the male and chew at them. So this is a combination of bite marks and sucker marks from a male that's been battling too much. And this is my fault, because the stocking density was too high for the males. Sometimes I push my limits because the males are less saleable than the females, so I'll raise them together to try to get them acclimated, and I'll keep the males together separately. But if there's too many in a small space, then they'll really start chewing on each other. All right. Going back. So here's the fun part of cuttlefish. After all that displaying, they get a female in town, they're going to spend a lot of time courting her and a lot of time mating with her. And this starts at about 3 months and goes on for the rest of their life. This is two males, actually. This is another thing that happens if you put males too close, is they're so charged up that they're just looking for a pair of tentacles. And so this male is saying, no, I'm a boy. The other male is saying, doesn't matter, we're going for it. Nobody can see us back here. She's not looking. But there he is saying again, after another attempt at mating, I am a boy, please back off. Here's a coloration that I rarely see. This is how desperate he is. Look at this, white and black. Doesn't matter, still going for it. But when they do find a receptive lady, it's a beautiful thing. Here's the males shortly after copulation, and she took they do that puff after inserting his arm into the mantle. And why is he coming over? He's hungry. He actually disentangled from a mating embrace just to eat. It's so bad, the interest in food and mating at the same time, that I've actually had some of my cuttles strike food in a mating embrace. It's so sweet. Look at them. One of the other ways to sex cuddles is that the males are on top. They have their two tentacles on top of her forehead. So if I find two in an embrace, then I can separate them based on who's on top. Oh, a little love stroke there. They're not shy about it either. As you can see, there's a lot of time spent filming cuddles mating with them right at the glass.
but they're affectionate. That's why they're called cuttlefish. Sometimes, if I'm feeling affectionate, I call them snugglefish. Oh my gosh, I'm at 28 minutes. This is fine.
Go down in the
I'm okay?
City.
All right. So here is a misfire. Why is this a misfire? If you look at that little white puff on the male, that's a spermatophore that didn't quite make it. And I'm not sure he knows what happened there, so I thought of the there's something about Mary when there was another misfire. So, despite the quarrels, they are quite cuddly. They do get along, especially as juveniles. And they spend a lot of time stacked up on top of each other, which is a fun part of their life cycle. Here is my incredible egg-laying video that I was so excited to get. The first scene on the left is a female who has just produced her egg pouch, and she takes it over to that acro branch. She wraps her arms around it and does whatever magic that happens there to stick that egg against the acro branch. So I'd love to show you the footage, but the problem with that is if you have an iPhone and you go to take a video and it's in photo mode, you just get two photos of the event. It's one of the saddest things that's ever happened to me. So I was really lucky that I actually finally got footage, and this happened 2 weeks ago, where I saw the female with puffed out tentacles, and I was like, there is an egg in there. She was trying to be coy about it. She's hanging out at the bottom. It's like, nothing to see here. But I'm looking at the egg bundle above, and I kept filming, and I got it. It's not as graphic as the one that I missed, but there she is attaching it to the bundle and building her little nest. This is a weird setup here. That's why there's so many in there. These were breeding a lot younger than I thought they would. They were breeding in a little over two months. So here was one of my most successful egg bundles. It's almost 200 eggs. They will lay between 12 and 200 in each bundle. As you can see, they're just like big clusters of black grapes. There's little to no parental care provided by the bandensis. They're just counting on the eggs being gently circulated in aquarium water, and that's what you want to focus on. You want to make sure that there's enough, kind of like bang eye eggs. You know, they don't need a lot of specific care. You just want to make sure they're getting good flow. So they will lay on acro branches, they'll lay on plants, they'll lay on tank walls, they'll lay on plumbing. They'll lay on a lot of different structures. So just throw a variety in there and they'll lay for you. And this is something that is achievable by every single person I've sent my cuttlefish out to. They're getting eggs as a result if they get a male and female. So it's a fun part of the life cycle. Makes the 12 months not so painful. Here's some incubators. On the left, I have them in an acrylic cube with an air stone just to pull the water around them. On the right, I have it in a basket that's mesh on all sides, so they get lots of flow. And here I have it set up in a 10-gallon tank with a power head cranked down just to give that very, very gentle flow. If it's too much flow, it's going to break off of the substrate that it's attached to, and then it's on the ground, and then you got to put in an incubation basket. But you can see when the eggs develop, the ones that were laid first at the top of the bundle are the biggest. That's because they inflate as they grow. This is a bandensis that the egg sheath came off of the egg, and you can see the baby underneath. This one isn't going to survive. That's why I'm giving it some gentle pokes. But I want to show you that it's like a miniature cuttlefish developing in there, and you can see that big yolk in his tentacles on the front side of them. But they're reactive. You know, they'll swim around in that egg. If you approach an egg cluster, some of the babies will swim to the bottom of the egg when they were at the top. It's pretty cool. I think this is just more of that. So in a sake for time, I want to show you another tumble method. So Brett Grass at Monterey Bay Aquarium is another person, along with Rich, who's been very successful in breeding cuttlefish. And he gave us the idea for tumblers. That's the tumbler that our aquarium made. And again, it's just providing that very, very gentle flow. We put them in these baskets. This is actually not bandensis. As you can see, this is a Pharonis eggs, or Pharaoh's cuttlefish, which is a big, beautiful cuttlefish. This is the footage of the eggs hatching. So we had them in a higher tumbling basket to get them to hatch, and we make sure that they don't have any yolk left when we put them in this type of basket. When they hatch with a little bit of yolk on it, often their survival rate is much less. But if they're feeling too tumbled, too jostled, they'll hatch at any age. This is the size of a baby bandensis cuttlefish. Look how cute. I was going to put a ruler, and then I thought, let's put it in an aquarist terms. Let's do zip ties and fish bag rubber bands. So this is about 3/16 of an inch. It's somewhere between an eighth and a quarter. They're super tiny. The one on the left is one that hatched prematurely with that yolk in his tentacles. And baby bandensis are difficult. They're very difficult to raise because they can starve quickly if you're not feeding them appropriate amounts each day. And they're not going to eat easily for you. It's about providing enough live mysis in their enclosure that they have it available in front of them, running in front of them, but not so many that they're intimidated by them. So you got to find that balance, and you got to make sure that they have hiding structures that don't shelter them too much for the mysis. But it's possible. Mysis costs somewhere between 10 cents per mysis and 25 cents per mysis. So you can imagine feeding them these live mysis can be extremely costly unless you have a culture system. Amphipods have been very effective at raising cuttlefish too. That's something that Rich has done. That's something that we do too, especially when we've let our mysis culture go low. Then I'm digging around in tanks, and you can get it out of macroalgae and locally out under rocks. So the babies, you want to keep them, again, at the right density in the tank so that they have enough exposure to food. You can keep them in pretty high densities with each other since they're not aggressive until about 2 months of age. And it seems like they appreciate the company. I recently raised 5 baby cuttles in a very tall 10-gallon tank as an experiment and fed them some of the wild mysis coming out of the reef system. And even though they had this huge expanse covered in gravel and plants and all these decorations, all 5 babies were always together. Wherever they were in the tank, they were together. So they like each other. Here's how you can see that they're just miniature versions of the adults. This is a small little condiment cup. And here's one of the biggest blessings that I had working at the Long Island Aquarium. There's a local river that's brackish behind the aquarium, and that has large river mysis bloom once a year. And so for a few months, we'll get these enormous river mysis, which is on the left there, which is great because the live mysis that's used in these in cultures for bioassay tests are teeny. So when these cuttlefish get to be, you know, a third of an inch, then they're having to eat just tons and tons of this expensive mysis. So this big fat mysis on the left was a real blessing, as is the breeding grass shrimp by the aquarium too. Those are on the right. So once their babies hatch, I also have a great transition food between mysis and grass shrimp. This is my little collection station that I wheel out to the dock sometimes every 2 weeks, sometimes every other day, depending on my catch rate. And I'll fill it with water and grab as much as I can because they eat a lot. Here's some fun stuff. These are stocking techniques. This is that algae sort of look. I'm an algae. Don't worry about it. This is one of the funnier stalking techniques. He's approaching a mysis. I like to call it the stealthy elephant. Nothing to see here. Don't worry about it. I'm just going to come your way. But what this actually is, there's a paper written, and they think it's mimicking the behavior of a nassarius snail. So there is a method to his madness. This is what my baby tanks look like at about a little over a month. All of them just press their little puppy dog faces against the glass all day, every day when you're up there. So poor Joe, he's up there even more than I am. And he's walking by doing his normal reef maintenance, and all these little puppy dog eyes staring at him, begging for food. Sometimes he gives in, which is good. Try to get as much food to them as they'll eat. Feeding them at least once a day, definitely twice a day, 3 times a day is the best. The more, the merrier.
All right. This is a cool video. This is a, I got it by luck. That's what happens when a baby tries to attack something a little bit bigger than what he should be eating. So here it is in slow motion. One, two, three, four, five. And then he got control of the situation. Those are some of my first, that's my first breeding pair that I have on the left. They're near and dear to my heart. And I'm really excited. I got into the fifth generation. You know, people who breed these cuttlefish who've been doing it in public aquariums longer than me, fifth is nothing to them. They do sixth, seventh, eighth, but I'm really excited to be able to get them to this place, and I'm constantly refreshing the gene pool by trading with other public aquariums. And then we make sure that we're, you know, not necessarily collecting from the wild, but we're keeping things fresh and so new. So what's next? I would love to do every other cephalopod. I'm not sure I'm qualified, but I would love to try bobtails, and I would love to get my hands on some flamboyants to give those a shot as well. You can see the baby, he struck the glass on the bottom, but here they are. I didn't realize I left the cup of grass shrimp by their tank, and I look over and they're all striking at the glass. Felt bad for them. And this is why I do this, because it's fun. That's, if I had the audio on, it would be me going, oh, oh God, oh no. Because sometimes if you feed them by hand and they latch onto you, this is a very natural reaction, but they're not gonna let go. So luckily I haven't flung any across the reef yet, but it's not distant in the future. All right, so here's some references I can recommend. This is a great book, the cephalopods on the left, and then if you're looking for more scientific data on the cuttlefish, the one on the right is actually free online that you can download, and it gives you great information on the biology. And of course, this guy loves to get texts and emails whenever you feel like about any little cuttlefish question you have. Oh, I forgot your phone number. I'm sorry. I'll put that on the next one. There's cuttlefish references online, of course. Drum and Croaker has great articles by Rich and others. Packhead.net is Rich's website where he has a lot of cuttlefish information. Tonmo.com is an entire cephalopod community where they post their experiences, their knowledge, ask questions, and they put a lot of very, very helpful articles online. Daniel Pond wrote a pretty long article on it too, and I always recommend JFGI. So I'm happy to say that these cuttlefish are available for sale now through ReefGen. This is the ReefGen cuttlefish available through Live Aquaria, and you can buy them singly or for a pair. And we also have them available at Unique Corals. They're on display right now at MACNA, and they're for sale at MACNA this conference. They're also on the reefs.com booth for display. So I'll be over there today if you guys want to come and talk more about cuttlefish. And thank you. So that's the thank you slide.